Hello friends, this is Dr. Sangeeta and welcome back to another lecture of Rental Paathshala where we help you understand and learn an industry better and easy way. And today's topic, we are going to talk about the component of a removable partial denture which connect the one side of the removable partial denture to the other side. So today's video, we are going to talk about the major component of the removable partial denture. So without further ado, let's get started. So before we get started, make sure to subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon so that you don't miss any of our future videos. So talking about today's topic is the mandibular major connector. Last video, we have spoken about the maxillary major connector. And see, the difference between maxillary and mandibular major connector is actually that we did beading in the maxillary major connector, if you remember. That we scraped out little bit of cast so that there is a positive contact, right? But in case of mandibular major connector, we are not making tight contacts. Actually, in fact, we are giving some relief. Suppose if we are doing, especially in case of distal extension case. For that, because we are giving relief to the soft tissues, because there is also tongue, and because if we are doing beading, then there will be no relief. So in case of mandibular, actually, because there is tongue also, there is the mucosa is also sensitive. So actually we give relief. Now, second part is that if it impringes the tissue, so inferior border, it is going to create some problem, right? So we have to make sure that also. So the important thing which we do is with the help of a periodontal probe. See, this is a periodontal probe, if you guys can see in the diagram. So first of all, we are reading McCragan Removable Partial Denture book, 11th edition, and the chapter number 5, Major and Minor Connector. So we are on figure number 5-7. See, if you don't have a book, you don't require to have a book, because I have been telling you this, that if you hear or listen or watch Ramayan from any video, any serial, the story is going to be same. So the story of all of the things will remain the same. No matter whichever book you follow. So doesn't matter if you don't have the McCragan, you can read from the book which is available to you. If you don't have any book, then also you can refer articles, you can take the presentations from the SlideShare. So you can refer from anywhere. So talking about how do we measure before giving the mandibular major connector. So we are going to take a periodontal probe, and what we do, we ask the patient, see, the tongue of the patient is uplifted, if you can make out from this diagram. So we ask the, actually we ask the patient to touch the upper lip with the help of tongue. So actually the upper border, vermilion border, we ask the patient to touch. So that way the tongue is lifted and we put a periodontal probe, and then we check the depth. Check the height of the floor of the mouth, so that now we have the idea about the tissues, the relationship. See, if the from the floor of the mouth till the teeth surface, till this incisor area, if we have 8 millimeters, that means we can give the lingual bar, right? So we can give the lingual bar that we have already spoke about. So the criteria for lingual bar is that, see, for lingual bar is that, now for a lingual bar, the thing is that this is going to be half pear shape, right? So this is the lingual bar. Suppose now you should have the depth till the tissue surface, you should have at least 8 millimeters. Why you want 8 millimeters? See, some books it is written 5 and 3, but since we are following McCragan, so I'm telling you this. So 4 millimeters is going to be this much, the actually length of the lingual bar. Then up above also we need, up till here we need 4 millimeters relief, right, away from the gingival tissue. So this is the reason that, see, because lingual bar is the most accepted. If there is 8 millimeter of vertical height or the depth or the height of till the floor of the mouth, then we always, mostly we use the lingual bar. If there is no sufficient space present, then we can go for the modification, that is our sublingual bar. Sublingual bar, what we do? We actually go sublingually. So in this sublingual bar, we actually go sublingually like this, right? So this is going to be our sublingual bar, which is actually, it is a modification of lingual bar, just that it is placed deep inside the lingual sulcus. When there is not adequate space available for the lingual bar, then we can use the sublingual bar. So next one, if you can see, this is a half pear shape. So this is, I'm going to cut a pear into half and I'm going to show you. Always, whenever you are reading the shapes, I always recommend you to visualize everything. See, now you can see. Now this is a pear, right? We are going to cut into half. And now you can see that this is going to be the shape of a lingual bar. Okay. Half pear shape. So this is our lingual bar. Then coming to the second one, which one we have is the lingual plate. The another name, see, linguo plate, we can say the lingual plate. Now what is there in the lingual plate? In the lingual plate, actually we are taking the incisors also. So again, it is also pear shape only, but we are extending up to the lingual surfaces of the teeth. See, from the lingual surfaces of the teeth, it is thin, but as we going inferiorly, this is little bit thicker, like this. This is our linguo plate. So this, the difference is that as you can see this, in the lingual bar, it was just there present in the tissues, but in the linguo plate, it is also covering the inside, the lower borders of the teeth also. And you can see in this diagram now. See, this is a metal plate. As you can see, the indentations. So this is also covering some areas of the teeth, cingulum areas, below the cingulum areas of the teeth also it is covering. So this is the superior border. As you can see, this is the superior teeth. If you can see, make out, this is so thin plate of metal. As you can see in this diagram, in this picture, very thin plate of metal. So superiorly it is a thin plate of metal. Okay, and it has scalloped border. As you can see, it is on the contouring of the tooth. So it is just contacting the teeth above the cingula. So basically they are having knife edge margins. And basically what it is doing is it is reducing the wedging effect. So if we talk about what happens in case of a lingual bar. So if you see the lingual bar, this particular diagram is a lingual bar. Okay, what happens? There is an accumulation of food from here. So the patient is quite uncomfortable because the food keeps on going inside. But what happens in case of a lingual plate? As you can see, the lingual plate, because it is following the contour of the tooth, so it is having tight contact. So there is no food entrapment. So that way it has a bit advantage over the lingual bar because there is no food entrapment. Also, one more thing, if you can see, suppose if we are giving RPD, okay, so many patients have weak periodontal support of the teeth. So suppose if the anterior teeth are mobile, if there is a weak periodontal support, so this can also act as a splinting, because it is taking, it is combining all these teeth and providing a rigid framework, so that the teeth are not mobile anymore. So it is a kind of, it is working as a kind of splinting also. So you can also use this lingual plate, lingual plate, in case of if the teeth are periodontally weak. Also, we can use in case where there is a excessive vertical resorption. So in case where there is an excessive vertical resorption, then we can also give this plate. In class 1 situations where the patient has undercut in the ridges. Now, talking about the next one, we have lingual plate. After the lingual plate is our sublingual bar, we have already covered, because it is again a modification of a lingual bar. So coming to the double lingual bar or the continuous bar. So this is lingual bar with a continuous bar. It has many names. First, let's just understand what is cingulum bar. So cingulum bar is just a bar which is placed in the cingulum area of the teeth. As you can see in the diagram, actually you can make all these diagrams. You can draw all these diagrams. And first of all, you will get tables in each and every book. Okay. regarding all these major connector, I have been telling you this, that whichever book you read, each and every book you will get the table in which advantages, disadvantages, indications, contraindications are there. My purpose is to make you understand that where do we use it actually clinically, so that you never forget it. So cingulum bar is, we are placing in the cingulum of the teeth. So we are placing it here in the cingulum area of the teeth, right? In the cingulum area. So this is where we are placing this cingulum bar. So next, talking about the double Canadese bar, double lingual bar, continuous bar. So we have all these names. As the name suggests, it is a continuous bar. That means it is going to be continuous in nature, right? So there are two actually bars in this. As the name suggests, double lingual bar. It is not double lingual plate. First of all, try to understand the terms, what it is telling. So this is a double lingual bar. That means there are going to be double bars, but both are present lingually. As simple as that. No big deal, no rocket science. See what happens in this case. We have two bars. One is present in the superior, one is present inferiorly, right? So the bar which is present inferiorly, or we can say the lower bar, this lower bar is similar to the lingual bar. Now the upper bar is similar. This lower bar is actually half pear shape, because it is a lingual bar. So if we are talking about upper bar, then upper bar is half oval in cross section. Now this upper bar is like a cingulum bar. See, this is a cingulum bar. So there is going to be upper bar like this, covering the cingulum areas of the teeth. So the upper bar is going to be like this, and lower bar will go like here, right? So there are no diagram that I can show you. This is the only diagram we have. Okay, so we are going to have two. One in the cingulum area, which will be placed in the cingulum area. Other one, the lower one. So we have two bars. In the double lingual bar, we have two lingual bars. One the upper one, second one is the lower one. Upper one is half oval in shape. It is cingulum. Cingulum bar. Lower one is the lingual bar. So lower one is pear in cross section. And actually, we maintain a distance between both of these bars. And they at least should be 2 to 3 millimeters away from each other, right? So then the upper bar will be going into the embrasures, and lower bar will be present on the tissue surface, right? So now both of these bars are connected with the acrylic. The second most important thing in the double lingual bar is that we support teeth in the double lingual bar. So what we do actually, what happens in case of, suppose, let me just draw here, these are the incisors, right? Four lower incisors. Then we have the canine area, okay? Then we have the premolar area, right? First premolar. So what we do in case of a double lingual, or I can say Canady, or I can say continuous bar, now what happens? First of all, there is going to be the upper bar in the cingulum area, right? So it is going like this. It will follow the contour. So it is going to be like this. And there is going to be the lower bar, right, which is similar to our lingual bar. Now both of these bars are connected between the canine and the premolar. First thing, that both of these are connected between the canines and the premolar area. You can see that first premolar area. Second thing is that we are placing a rest for the upper bar. So for the retention of the upper bar, for the stabilization, we are placing two rest on each of the side of the upper bar. So both of these rest are actually placed on the mesial surface, mesial fossa of the premolar. So there are two things. First is that the two bars are connected at the canine and the premolar area, right? And the second thing is that you are providing rest. That is also mandatory. So you have to provide actually rest on the maximum to maximum. You can go posterior, maximum posteriorly you can go up till the mesial surface of our first premolar. You cannot go more than mesial fossa. You cannot go beyond the mesial fossa of the first premolar area, right? So this is about the double lingual bar. So where do we use it? Now one more thing. See, this is also giving, providing and protection in case of periodontally weak teeth. Right. Where do we actually use it clinically when there is spacing present between the teeth? Suppose if there is spacing present between the teeth. Now what happens? I'm going to show you in the diagram book also. So what happens? We do the step back design. Suppose if spacing is present, I'm showing you this, the lingual area, right? This is the lingual area. This is this area, lingual area, not the labial. So what we do, we do a step back design, because suppose if we are doing plates here, then what happens? This part of metal will be visible from the front. Suppose if spacing is there, then the metal part will be actually visible from the front, right? So what we do in that case? We do a step back design. So we are going to modify this design something like this. So this is how we are going to modify our design. So this is our upper bar and this one is our lower bar. So this is a kind of step back design of double lingual bar. So in case where spacing is present, in all those cases also we use this double lingual bar. So guys, have a look now. Now see, this is interrupted lingoplate. We call this kind of plate, actually we call interrupted lingoplate, right? So in this case, actually this is with a step back design. So this is how it looks like. Because if spacing is present, then we are not putting metal part in the spaces. Now the last one we have is the labial bar. As you can see, rest of all these major connector we have placed lingually except the labial bar. Now labial bar is actually placed labially, right? So why do we use this? Suppose if in case of lingual inclination is present, lot of lingual inclination is present, then the path of insertion removal is going to be interrupted. And let me show you with the help of a diagram. Now what happens in case if teeth are lingually inclined? So lingually inclined teeth will be inclined lingually. So will be like this, right? So they will be inclined lingually. So what happens in this case? Suppose this is the normal ridge. So what happens if we want to give a lingual bar? Suppose if we want to give a lingual bar. So if I want to give a lingual bar for the path of insertion or path of removal, I have to give a lingual bar here, which is far away from the mucosa. So in all those cases, actually we give the labial bar. Where there is a deep undercut present in the lingual part of the tissues, where there is lingually inclined teeth, where there is also tori present. Where there is a big tori present in the lingual area, right? So that also we can give the labial bar. But again, patient discomfort will be there, distortion of lip will be there, and most importantly, an aesthetic. Patient won't feel happy about having a lingual bar, a labial bar, I'm sorry. So guys, this is about the mandibular major connectors. So we have covered the lingual bar, we have covered the lingoplate. Lingoplate we can also call the lingual plate. Lingoplate or lingual plate, one and the same thing. Then this is a sublingual bar, which is a modification of a lingual bar, which is just placed at the sulcus. So it is placed at the sulcus, sublingual bar. What did I say? Did I say the cingulum bar? I actually know, sometimes I just keep on telling blabbering. I don't even remember. Sometimes it's just words just skip out of my mouth. So this is the sublingual bar, right? We are placing at the corner, at the junction, at the sulcus. Then we have the double lingual bar, or we can say the Canadese bar or the continuous bar. Then we have the labial bar. These are the important major connectors. Each and every book you will get the table of advantages, disadvantages, indication, contraindication. But I hope that you guys are now clear with the mandibular major connector, which is actually a difficult topic to understand. So I hope that you guys have understood it well, and if you have enjoyed the video, then give it a thumbs up. Also, you can comment in the comment section below, and now there is a link in the description below to support me on Paytm as well as on PayPal to make free videos for you guys and to make free notes. And if you haven't checked it out, I have prepared the notes for Surveyor, which are now well available. So you can go into the Surveyor video and just you can click in the link in the description. There is a link provided in the description below. So guys, this is about, that's it, the major connectors. Next video we are going to talk about the minor connector and the direct retainers. I hope that you have enjoyed the video, so give it a thumbs up. And guys, take care, keep studying, keep learning, stay motivated, and I'll see you soon in the next video.